Thanks so much for joining me. I'm Julie Philipp. And today, WXXI Innovation Trail reporter Zack Seward is joining me for the show. You this week covered a conference in Geneva that focused on hydrofracking.
Yep, high volume horizontal hydraulic fracturing, to be precise, actually.
A mouthful.
Indeed. And the school's Finger Lakes Institute was hosting a 2-day conference on the future of gas extraction.
The school was a Hobart and William Smith
College. Hobart and William Smith Colleges in Geneva. And they're looking at the future of gas extraction in New York State. And that was really the
And really,
topic.
They wanted to focus on the facts, get
focus
away from
facts,
a lot of the drama.
Heavy on facts, light on drama, about 140 experts from all over this issue.
Okay. Before we get into some of the details of what happened at the conference, could you just sort of walk us through briefly what hydrofracking is?
Absolutely. Well, in hydrofracking, or fracking as it's known, it's a drilling technique. So drillers, they drill a well thousands of feet downward into the earth, and then they hit this layer of rock known as shale. At that point, they turn the drill bit actually and go at a 90-degree angle and go thousands of feet sideways into the shale itself. Now, once the pipe is drilled, what they do is they pump millions of gallons of water that's mixed with sand and toxic chemicals. They pump that down into the pipe, which the high pressure forces cracks in the shale itself.
Okay.
That releases the natural gas. The wastewater flows back up the pipe, and then it's followed by the natural gas itself.
So that's how they get it out. Now, the conference, they wanted to focus on facts and not drama, but this really is a hot button issue.
It's really become a hot button issue, and it's increasingly become a lightning rod in many parts of upstate New York. The technology has turned parts of the Northeast into what some call the Saudi Arabia of natural gas. That's because it's allowed gas companies to tap into what's known as the Marcellus Shale, which is a massive formation under about 2/3 of Pennsylvania and about 1/3 of New York State. So for some, Marcellus represents an energy game changer, and for others, it represents a potential environmental catastrophe. At Thursday's conference, organizers said it could be both of those things. Hobart and William Smith professor Beth Kinney helped put on the event. She says the goal wasn't to argue for or against hydrofracking, but to figure out how to best plan for it.
We all use energy. We all heat our homes. We all cook food. Right now, we're all using air conditioning because of the heat. But it is not our role to try to build up the wall. It's our role to try to be really creative and collaborative in trying to produce the kinds of tools we need to create the world we want to live in. And I'm an attorney, and I really believe that a real purpose of the law in general is to envision and then create the world you want to be in through regulation. That's not the only component to creating that world, but it's a very important one.
Kinney says the goal of the 2-day conference was to bring together experts on Marcellus Shale development. She says the conference of moderates was designed to be heavy on facts and helpful to the region.
We're just one small part of that, and we serve the Finger Lakes communities, and so we're trying to serve as a resource for the Finger Lakes communities. And in doing that, we're serving as a resource for a larger community as well, I believe.
A big part of New York's experience to date has been looking across the border at Pennsylvania. The Keystone State has undergone a full court press of natural gas extraction in recent years, often to mixed results. John Quigley was Thursday's keynote speaker. He used to be in charge of Pennsylvania's Department of Conservation and Natural Resources. He says New York will have to learn from Pennsylvania's mistakes.
So New York's going to have to make its own decisions, but if anything, I think Pennsylvania has demonstrated that there are as many opportunities as there are threats, and it's all about finding the right balance. And the states that are going to be successful in handling these shale plays are the ones that will find the balance.
Quigley says a big part of finding that balance depends on having an informed debate, and he also says that's a major challenge.
The real challenge here is getting it right, and details matter. And there's been so much hyperbole around this issue on all sides. You know, the industry touting its benefits, saying, trust us. Some in the environmental community just being completely against the process, ignoring things like climate change. We have to get to a rational discussion, and that's difficult.
In New York, the debate has become especially contentious as the state irons out its regulatory guidelines on hydrofracking. The agency in charge of regulating hydrofracking is the Department of Environmental Conservation. They've been looking into the issue for years and have said no permits for the technique will be issued until they finish their regulatory process. Stuart Gruskin used to be a commissioner at the DEC. He was with the agency when they put out the first draft of their regulations back in 2009.
New York has a window of opportunity to be making the decisions that are necessary to take the best advantage of the boom part of this and to mitigate the consequences of the bust part of this.
Gruskin says New York has taken a think-first, drill-later approach to avoid the pitfalls Pennsylvania has already experienced. The Oscar-nominated documentary Gasland helped dramatize the issue with footage of tap water that can be lit on fire and ugly-looking industrial drilling sites. Gruskin says New York will benefit from Pennsylvania's mistakes.
I think what happened in Pennsylvania is that industry got ahead of the regulators, and that's exactly what DEC and New York State has been trying to avoid. Recognizing that there is the potential for significant environmental adverse consequences, the state has taken a position that it ought to be prepared to deal with those before the activity takes place.
Earlier this month, the DEC put out an incomplete draft of its updated fracking guidelines. Among other things, it increased protection for some New Yorkers by banning the process in the watersheds that provide drinking water for New York City and Syracuse. But that left some feeling left out. Mark Morris of the Yates County Legislature said that county was looking for a similar exemption for Keuka Lake, but wasn't granted one. Now Morris and the county's Marcellus Shale Board is looking at its alternatives. He thinks New York should pursue hydrofracking, but that safety protections need to be airtight.
I think we need to be careful where we're going to do that. In the places where you have the highest risk, I think you need to make sure you're protecting those until you have enough good history of performance in New York that it's safe.
Morris is at the Hobart and William Smith Conference to figure out what Yates County's options will be until then. And that's what conference organizers say the event is all about: building the tools communities can use to shape their own hydrofracking destinies.
Mm-hmm. Now, they really stressed that this was a conference about facts and information and providing tools and all of that, but did they address the fact that it's still very much an emotional issue for some?
Of course, and that former DEC commissioner, Stu Gruskin, he mentioned that this is really the perfect storm of these three big issues, as we'll see in this clip here.
It's a big deal because each of these propositions are true. There's a potential for environmental harm, there's a potential for economic prosperity, and there's a potential for sound energy policy. So when you put all those together, you get people with very strong feelings expressing them in different ways.
We're joined at the table now by someone else who covers this topic, environmental reporter Steve Orr from the Democrat and Chronicle. Thanks for joining us today.
My pleasure.
Now, you know, we've talked about the environmental impacts of hydrofracking, and for a lot of people that means water. That's what comes to their mind, in the drinking water, but you covered a different angle of this.
I did. There, as you said, water has gotten everybody's attention, and for good reason, but some groups point out that there are air quality issues related to widespread hydraulic fracturing. That seems to be clearly the case, and I noted in a story the other day, the DEC has 130 pages of air quality regulations or air quality guidelines written into their fracking rules that are out for comment or will be out for comment soon. Environmental groups say that's not good enough. One of them pointed to a study, citizen study, kind of a low-level thing, but more of a red flag raiser. That was done recently in Colorado and New Mexico. Folks grabbed some samples of air near gas drilling installations, had it tested, and sure enough, they found a variety of toxic chemicals, several of which are potential or suspected carcinogens.
Did that report specify whether it was the process itself or the level of industrial activity surrounding the process?
It's not, the study was not terribly thorough, so it's hard to say, but I think there are issues related to air quality, both on a low level from an individual well that's being drilled, and also sort of on a regional basis. If you're in a location that has a number of gas wells that are active and has a number of the support facilities, compressor stations and so on, that essentially are small factories, the concern anyway is they'll have a regional impact on air quality.
Gotcha. And one of your colleagues in the Southern Tier recently reported that, you know, up to a third of the Finger Lakes is leased to gas companies at this point. Is that something to be concerned about?
Well, yeah, probably. I mean, I'm sure people are. I saw it was a study done by an environmental group out of Albany. Very carefully plotted where all of the leases are in eight counties in the Finger Lakes region, and I saw the maps the other day that they produced very meticulously, and it struck me immediately that I now understood the sort of anecdotal complaints and concerns that have been articulated by winery owners. Essentially, the Cayuga, Seneca, Keuka Lakes, all are bordered or ringed in some cases by lands that have been leased by gas drilling companies.
So there's a real density.
And as it turns out, for better or worse, especially the southern parts of those lakes are in the gas-rich part of the Marcellus and some other underground formations, and are maybe not the first place that drillers will go, but are probably in the second tier. And so there will be drilling in that area unless something happens to stop it.
Now, you mentioned with the air quality that study was done out in Colorado, but we're looking at Pennsylvania. Has anybody looked into the air quality issue in Pennsylvania that you're aware of?
I'm not aware of any broad studies. There may well have been that I haven't heard about, but I think there have been complaints in Pennsylvania, as in other places, that there are localized problems where people complain of irritation of the eyes and the throat, of foul odors, of all sorts of things that come with a lot of different kind of industrial facilities, and that's what these are, industrial facilities.
Did they talk about that at the conference?
They did. The public health aspect of this whole issue was definitely addressed there. A speaker from, I think, University of Pittsburgh was actually at the URMC earlier this week. I know I covered it. I think you may have made mention to it, who has done some research, looked into it. He's saying there's a whole bevy of health issues that could potentially be there. Nothing definitive at this point. But he's saying it's something that people definitely need to be concerned with.
And one of the points that gentleman made is that, I had seen some material he'd written before, and he made the point that, look, when hydraulic fracturing occurs in communities where it happens, there will be concerns arise. Somebody will notice that everybody's getting sick. Somebody will notice that five neighbors have gotten cancer, and all of a sudden, boom, they'll be blaming it on hydraulic fracturing, on the gas wells in their part of the county or the state. And somebody's going to have to go in and try and figure out what's causing those problems. They said it's inevitable when you get this much of activity and the level of concern that exists now that there will be, you can't call them health scares, but there will be occasions that come up. And I know he's urging.
It's the same sort of issue when you have industrial activity going on.
Sure.
Are gonna keep
and I think his point was one thing that can be done is to try and do as much work in advance to understand what sort of air emissions or water quality concerns there might be associated with gas drilling, and what sort of public health implications there could be, so that, or at least people are forearmed and forewarned to know what to look for and what kind of controls might be best.
Gotcha. Changing gears to another part of this energy equation, let's go to wind power. It's been a while since we've heard anything about this prospective offshore wind farm in Lake Ontario. What's the status of that?
Well, it's not by any means official, but the impression I have is that it's probably defunct. I think it proved to be
hot button.
Well, it was a hot button issue with people along the shoreline. It was almost uniform that every community from one end of Lake Ontario to the other and also in Lake Erie just didn't like the idea of these big things being erected within sight of their homes and businesses on the shore. It's not, as I said, it's not dead, but they're way past the deadline when they were supposed to announce a plan. I think what's happened is it's proved to be much more expensive than they thought. And the subsidy that would be required from the state, because the state power authority was willing to subsidize it, is probably a much higher figure than they're willing to bear at this point. But we don't know. I know we constantly pester them to find out what's going on, and they.
And Zack, we're focusing. It wasn't exactly offshore wind because it was an island, Galoo Island. Mm-hmm. What's the status of that? Have you heard?
Yeah, I haven't heard, but that's a whole other issue that's raging up there, especially with the transmission lines. You talk about siting turbines. You also have to site the transmission lines themselves, which some people find those more objectionable than the turbines themselves.
Right. So it was a privately owned island. So he was the owner. Perhaps was okay with putting up those turbines on his island, but you're saying the transmission to shore and then off to places where the power is needed.
That's a regulatory process that they're still hammering through up there in the Thousand Islands region. There is a new piece of legislation out of Albany that may impact this discussion going forward. Article 10. What's the deal with that?
Yeah, you know, New York for roughly a decade had no law that governed the siting of power plants. The previous one had expired. They've been unable to renew it. That's why, as you've seen, it's been played out around here a couple of places. It fell to local communities to try and deal with proposed, mostly wind turbines were the issue, wind farms. And each one dealt differently, and each one tried to pass their own law and their own guidelines, and there evolved all sorts of legal battles and political fights.
So New York.
Yes. Well, yes and no. It was interesting to watch, and there were communities that were four square and back of wind, and then 6 months later they'd vote people out of office, and suddenly they were all opposed to it. What's happened now is the state, as part of Governor Cuomo's push to get things done in Albany, passed an Article 10 siting law that is somewhat similar, I guess, to the earlier one, but the part that's most of most concern, I guess, to anti-wind activists and others is that there would be a statewide siting board that would essentially make final decisions about whether a power plant, including a wind farm, mm-hmm. could be built in a given place or not.
And so taking that decision, making
taking
power.
It largely out of it. Yeah, I mean, local government would still have a say, and there would actually right. be funding available to a town board or so on to intervene in the process. But in the end, the state board would decide.
Okay, I've got to stop you both right there because we're out of time. But thank you so much for coming in today. Steve Orr, he is Democrat and Chronicle environmental reporter, and WXXI's Innovation Trail reporter, Zack Seward. You can find all of our Innovation Trail reports at WXXI.org.